to you by Penguin. The Secret of Haven Point, written and read by Lisette Auton. This book is dedicated to Alex David Gray. Footnote. Auntie, what are you doing? Editing my book? Who are you going to dedicate it to? I don't know yet. You could do it to me, Marky, or Mum. Okay, I'll have a think about it. Me. Dedicate it to me. They can have books 2 and 3. On language. A note from the author. In The Secret of Haven Point, Cap'n teaches Alpha and all the Wrecklings that language is really important and powerful. He is able to teach them that because I've been taught it too by incredible disabled people who I've had the good fortune to meet and work alongside and then call my friends. I made conscious choices in this book about the way the characters choose to describe themselves. These choices are based on the way I describe myself as a disabled person. I also asked my disabled friends about the language they use to describe their impairments and conditions, and then I used those words too. Person first language. Some people choose to use the phrase people with a disability. Identity first language. I choose identity first language when I say, I'm a disabled person, and it's the way my characters describe themselves too. It means that I focus on the fact that I think my body and brain are brilliant exactly the way they are. It says that society needs to change, not me. Disabled is a strong, empowering word. There is no shame in using it. Individual choice is very important, and we must always respect each other's decisions and be kind to each other when it comes to the words we choose for ourselves and the ways in which we describe our own impairments. I loved writing this book and getting to know all the characters, but I'm a bit nervous about my words going out into the world, not least because of the pressure I felt to get everything right. There are millions of books with non-disabled characters, and no one expects an author of one of those to get everything right. Those books feature lots of different characters doing all sorts of things, and if, as a reader, you don't like it, you can easily put that book down and pick another up instead. There are still too few books with disabled people getting up to things. That means there is a lot of pressure on a disabled author like me to represent everybody by using all the right words. So I have done my very best to write the story I wished I could have read and write the characters that were missing from my bookshelf. I really, really hope that if you enjoy this book, you might ask your librarian, your bookseller, your teacher for more books with disabled characters written by disabled people. And if they can't find many, perhaps you could ask them to find out why. And then, just maybe, we can make a big enough noise that tells the important people that these books are very necessary and wanted. And maybe then, if you'd like to be an author too when you grow up, your book describing characters in the important words that are right for you will find a home. Then there will be lots of books full of all sorts of disabled characters, having lots of different sorts of incredible adventures, written in different sorts of the right words that fill the shelves, so that everybody can have a choice about which powerful and important words they read. Chapter 1. Here are the facts. 1. My name is Alpha Lux. Alpha, because it's the first letter of the Greek alphabet, and I was Wreckling number 1. Lux, because the box I was found in had Lux soap flakes written all over it. 2. My face looks like a flame-grilled jellyfish. 3. I was raised by a mermaid. 4. I always tell the truth. I'll give you a bit of time to let that sink in. Ready? Then let's begin. Chapter 2. I was Haven Point's first Wreckling, but I certainly wasn't the last. There are 42 of us now, not including the mermaids. When you're a Wreckling, you mainly spend your days squabbling, eating, and planning adventures. Well, at least that's what my gang does. Oh, and Wrecklings also carry out wreckings, which is how we got our name. These days, we leave blankets in the Lux soap flakes box, and it's under the porch, so no new Wrecklings have to get damp and cold like I did. There was a full moon the night Cap'n found me. He thought I was a dead'un, nowt but blisters and scrawn. Back then, he lived in Old Ben, the lighthouse, all by himself. The mermaids only started coming ashore after I arrived. Cap'n was outside because he's terrified to sleep on a full moon. He says it's the height of sea magic, and he worries that the waves in his dreams will steal him away. So, imagine this. He's leaning on the rat-a-tat tree where the woodpecker lives, watching storm clouds roll across the horizon with the big sea magic moon in the sky. Old Ben, with his red and white stripes, standing to attention behind Cap'n, just like his shadow. The full moon sets Cap'n's nerves on edge. It's like he can feel the blood pulsing through him in time with the waves. All his senses are heightened, and shadows are making ordinary things look sinister and unreal. And then, this is where you get to meet me. He hears the cats fighting. They sound like babies squalling, and Cap'n is fed up of them unsettling the kitten that lives in his beard. He sighs and gets the broom from the porch. The whole world is made of shadows on a night like this. His boots crunch along the gravel and then shloop into the damp grass as he follows his ears, chuntering to himself as he goes. There's a box by the wall, and he thinks the blooming cats must have got themselves stuck in there. It's a really old box. It probably came from one of Cap'n's wreckings. I'll tell you about them later. And printed all over the top, it says, Lux Soap Flakes, cares for special things. I guess it did just that. I love it when Cap'n tells me this next bit, because he acts it out and does all the faces. He's really good at them. Cap'n sees that the lid of the box has been closed in that way where the four flaps fold over each other. He doesn't wonder how the box got folded back up after the cats got in. Instead, he's on guard with his broom drawn like a sword because he knows furious cats are about to come hurtling out at him, and the kitten in his beard is mewing and scrabbling. He holds his breath. He pauses. Then whips open the box, closes his eyes, and prepares to be attacked. Nothing happens. He opens one eye. He opens the other eye to see if it tells him what the first one did. He sees me. Holy Neptune, he whispers. Then he drops the broom and goes helter-skelter skidding on the shloopy grass and rings the huge brass bell, which has a handwritten label above it that says, Emergency use only. I mean, I was there and I don't remember any of it. But it's a damn good story the way he tells it. Chapter 3. At Haven Point, we're all bound by the laws of the water. Did you know that waves make different noises depending on how the day is feeling? When it's angry, the sea is just this low-down, rolling roar that sets you.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.